I'm Van.
I'm Sorry.
That's Booby.
And Jumpy and Ghosty.
Numa Tool Ferinoculum Record.
Mm-hmm.
This is a song I've been curious about, considering the biblical sort of pneuma is the Greek word for...
Oh, spirit or something?
Breath or wind, yeah.
Yeah, that's true. I didn't even realize that.
I think the Holy Spirit in Greek is like hagias pneumas or something like that. So that should be interesting. For time and topical political commentary, if you want to see why I am a very hard person to love, or why I am the most frustrating individual on the internet, go ahead to Middle America with Ben and Sori, and you will see. So, there we are.
I haven't seen the latest episode of your political commentary, so...
Yeah. Without further ado, this is Panama. I'm trying to mispronounce it. By Tool.
Okay, go.
Let's go. Start mellow. Always tell when it's Tool. Gotta quiet down. 2:30 in the morning.
Ready?
They are.
Yep.
What'd you think?
Lyrically, it was a little shorter than I expected it to be.
Yeah.
It was an interesting thing for Maynard to sing about, I thought, because right. I feel like he's, from what we've seen, kind of made it explicit that he doesn't want any parts of...
religion.
Yeah, religion and all that. So then for him to say these things, when he said, child, wake up, child, release the light, wake up now, that actually reminded me of when Jesus... raise that little girl from the dead.
Yeah.
What were you thinking when you were hearing it?
Well, I was thinking the same thing you were. I thought that he was sort of atheistic in his worldview, although I think, especially in our current modern zeitgeist, there's a vast difference between spirituality and religiosity.
Yeah, oh yeah. Yeah.
So I think, you know, I don't think he's necessarily getting religious, but he's definitely kind of coming out of the closet. Even though
this is the most recent album, right?
Right, right.
Yeah.
What do you call it? You know, the first Tool record that we did, Lateralis, was...
Yeah.
You know, you had the end on the record before Lateralis, and then it just went full-blown sort of philosophy and growth and personal, all that stuff. So he's always kind of been a spiritual guy, yeah. So this is interesting.
Born of one breath, one word.
Right.
Woo.
That reminded me of Acts 17.
We are all one spark, sun becoming.
Yeah, yeah. And
that's funny.
Well, it's also...
It reminded you of Acts what?
Acts 17, where he said, from all nations he created, from one man, he created all nations and men, and put them in there a lot of times in place so that they could... perhaps seek after him, even though he's not far from us. And then, of course, so that's the one man, humankind thing. And then, obviously, there's Genesis 2.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Which is probably what Maynard's actually alluding to with Genesis 2. Go ahead.
Where God, you know, creates Adam, and then he breathes into him the breath of life.
Right.
And, you know, I doesn't actually say that he says anything.
Right.
But I always imagine that he did.
Right. Which would be... kind of with the child wake up type of thing.
Yeah.
It'd be that kind of conversation.
I'm in a weepy mood tonight.
Yeah.
I can't say too much about it.
Yeah.
I loved, you talked one time on that. It was such a great thing that, it was so good. But anyway.
Yeah, it's a pretty crazy moment.
Yeah.
You know, where you see God, whether or not, you know, you believe anything in the Genesis account, but you see God basically speaking things into existence, and they're basically made animated. Mm-hmm. But with man, there's a very distinct difference. He's not made animated. A different word is used. He fashioned him out of the ground. But then it says the way that God animates Adam is to breathe the breath of life into his nostrils, basically. And, and the, obviously the picture is
face to face,
and Adam opens his eyes, you know, and you can, you know, take it from Maynard here. Child, wake up.
Yeah.
And then Adam opens his eyes, and lo and behold, there's his father and his creator. And, pretty beautiful thing. And so, you know, when he talks about we're one breath, you can imagine in childbirth or whatever, we're passing that one breath off to the, you know, to the next generation, et cetera, et cetera. And no matter how many 8 billion of us there are on this planet, from that perspective, we came from one single breath, which is a pretty crazy sort of, it gives you unity with people. If you can, if you can, the same spirit that blew into Adam's nostrils to animate him is the same spirit that all of us are animated.
Yeah.
By,
you know? Well, it's interesting because we always say, oh, you know, people say, oh, everybody bleeds red. You know what I mean? But this is another way of kind of saying that, you know, we're all born of one breath, one word. We're all one spark, sun becoming. And I liked that part. I don't really know what Maynard meant when he said sun becoming or child release the light. But to me, that was just, you know, when you think about like how we're supposed to go and be a blessing to the nations and release the light and, you know, that God is light. And so,
yeah, but,
you know, I don't think that's where he was going with it, but that's what it was.
I mean, Maynard's one of those guys you can never really know. Even I think somebody's in the Bible book. He's a closet Christian, you know. I think the sun becoming thing is, if you look at we are all one spark, then it says sun becoming. And the idea, I think, is when all these little sparks come together, then we're going to all burn bright like the sun.
Yeah. You're right.
Which again, is a sort of a, is a, you know, it says a righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of the Father, of their Father, I think, is the reference. So, hold on, I got to find it. Go ahead.
That's so funny. Talking. I remember I had seen that verse, this was years ago, on one of Sayla's little videos, and I reached out to you to be like, where is that verse? Is that an actual verse? Do you remember that?
Yeah. Matthew 13:43, then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's I think this is a pretty good piece of that, which is namely, we're all carrying that divine spark, and the kingdom of their Father context is very interesting considering our perspective on how the kingdom of God operates.
Mm-hmm.
It's not some ethereal afterlife thing. It's about the here and now and what the people who are conscious of the fact that God's spirit is in them, how they go about bringing people together to accomplish that end. And we believe we're going to be successful in doing so. Because if you can save me, you can save anybody. Good night. So I think, you know, that's sort of the basic gist of the song. You know, up above... we're spirit bound to this flesh. You know, again, this is the sort of a Gnostic idea that the human body or the physical body is somehow a prison.
Yeah.
And, which is extremely interesting considering Christianity does not view the physical body that way. It doesn't view the physical body as a prison. It views sin as the prison.
Right.
It doesn't view the physical body as a prison. We know that because Jesus showed up in a physical body.
Right.
And Jesus also resurrected in a physical body. He didn't float back up into the ether. He got a, you know, actual physical body. And so Christians don't believe that the body is a prison. The issue, though, is that Paul, especially Paul in the New Testament, uses the term flesh as a shorthand for sinful nature. So he says the acts of the flesh
That's what I was thinking. Right. That's why I was like, well.
The acts of the flesh are obvious, but that's specifically talking about our capacity to sin. It's not talking about our actual bodies or the problem.
Right, right. You know, there was a group of people that thought the body was the problem.
Well, that's Gnosticism.
Yeah.
Right? And, you know, the...
Were you just talking about that? But then I was like thinking through. Okay, so I was like thinking about other angles of so.
Well, yeah, the Gnostics had the idea that the physical world is terrible and horrible, and it was created by the demiurge, and so Yahweh's kind of portrayed as this sort of junior god who kind of screws up and creates matter, and all the rest of it. That's why you have those, you know, I talked to you about that, the picture of the guy, of Jesus laughing at the crucified Jesus.
Yeah.
Like that's yeah. Gnostic artwork, because it's basically Jesus is saying, everybody thinks I'm up there, but I'm really not. It's just basically a hologram because, you know, whatever. But I definitely see what he's saying from the Pauline perspective as a Christian. It's like, you know, we're bound to this flesh. And you see this in Galatians, what is it, 5. We just quoted where it says, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh.
Yeah.
So if it's talking about, like, our actual physical bodies are the problem and we need to get, like, completely spiritual, I disagree with that. But if he's talking about it in the Galatians 5 sense, which is we are in prison to our own sinful nature and we need the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, the same pneuma that animated our physical life to animate and control our spiritual life such that, you know, the body... you know, it was 1 Corinthians 6 or 15 where it says, you were bought with a price, therefore glorify God with your body.
Yep.
So, just a lot of really cool sort of spiritual ideas here.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I just think we're coming to a place now in America where sort of, like I said, Sam Harris talks about, you know, spirituality a lot and all that, and he's coming from an atheist framework, and it just tells me that I think all of us, you know, I think Kai said it best, you know, when he said, you know, when I pick up my newborn baby, I know that it's more than just chemical reactions going off in my brain. Like, you know, he's like, I know that.
Mm-hmm.
So, and Kai's not a Christian. Yeah. Tell the truth. But, you know, we're all starting to come to that consciousness, I think, that... Not necessarily all of us are becoming religious, but I think all of us are kind of looking around and being like, it's got to be something more than what's going on.
Well, that's what I was going to say. There's kind of like this, you know, like there's kind of like this cry in a lot of people's hearts where they're kind of like, you know, what am I here for? Like, right. I was, you know, that kind of like, what is the purpose of all of this? Like, there's this kind of knowing that there was some kind of purpose, even though you may not understand what the purpose is, but there's just, I don't know, this collective understanding that there is something.
Right.
Even though you may not know what that something is. And I think that in this song, like, he kind of captures the, not the, hey, we're here for something, but the, hey, we have, there is value to us, you know, and there's something about us that's just beyond the flesh, that just goes in other elements. This is semi-related. I was thinking about, you know, our kids are getting older and talking to them about, you know, relationships and things like that. And I was thinking, wow, like, this is going to be really cool, like, talking to them about how humans are made up of more. Because, like, normally there's like, oh, well, that person's attractive. Let me see if I can get to know them and see if I, you know, do we have fun together and stuff. But recognizing that there's body, soul, and spirit, and that, you know, are you connecting on a spirit? Because you can think somebody's super attractive but not meet on any other layers, and it's like, it's not going to last long.
Yeah.
You know, can you connect spiritually with one another? Or, like, in your souls, like, who you are and your personality and your likes and your dislikes. Like, there can be, like, you know, they always say, like, opposites attract.
Right.
But it's hard, you know, if people are just complete opposites in every area, it's hard to actually make that work year after year after year. But recognizing that people are more than those things, and recognizing that somebody is more than just their physical body too, because that changes. It doesn't stay the same.
Yeah. Well, so. And what you talk about the collective consciousness, he says, wake up, remember.
Yeah.
And,
yeah,
you know, I used to say a lot of times, you know, if I end up in a situation where I end up teaching the Bible, I say, look, man, most of you guys already know this stuff. My job is to just help you remember what you already know.
Yep.
You know, but you're like, no, you taught me a bunch of new stuff. But, you know, that's sort of the platitude that I try to put out there. But, yeah, that concept of remembering, like, we knew this before. And you kind of see it. You know, I talked about, you know, whole ayahuasca thing, and this is something that was created in the, you know, underdeveloped world, third world, hundreds of years ago. You know, it's like, it's so funny when people talk, ignorant goat herders, yada, yada, yada. And now you've got all of these millionaire tip of the edge of the spare, you know, technologists, whatever, in the Western world, you know, making hijra, you know, getting on a plane and flying over there to hang out in the woods with a shaman, and I'm sure, you know, Maynard's done that. And so it sort of creates...
he looks like the type that would.
Yeah, yeah. And I just think that Christianity or any of the majors carries with it so much baggage. But at the same time, people are drawn to God because they're made in his image. And so they're trying to find their way into...
Yeah.
We kind of talked about this in the Chris Cornell song, you know, where he... You know, he had so much baggage of Christianity, but still wanted to be in God's house type of thing.
Yep.
And I think that that's what's going on with Maynard and all of us to some degree. You know, we're always trying to figure out, like, how can I not suppress this loud voice in my ear that there's something more than this? While at the same time...
It demands of me an answer.
Right. And at the same time, there's this other voice saying, you don't want to be one of those people, you don't want to be a Christian. And
Right.
Quite frankly, I understand why. So, I think, like,
There's a collective unrest.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. I just think that he worded it really well. Numa, reach out and beyond.
Yeah.
Because part of it is, you know, people can become so introspective and so focused on, you know, their own selves and what they're going through or whatever, that you don't realize that there's something beyond you.
Yeah.
You're great, but you're not all there is.
Yeah.
And there's a sense in when we come together and we kind of, like... And then he says, you know, like we said, wake up, remember, we were born of one breath. And we, you know, we talk about being woke. You know what I mean? If someone's woke.
Right,
and
right.
This kind of woke is kind of interesting because it's like, it's a bigger woke than being woke. You know what I mean?
Well, I like it because Jordan Peterson basically says, look, man, if you want to change the world, do not protest in the street. Change yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much.
Sorry.
And hey, we're grinding for you guys. It's 2:50 a.m. But we got to get the people their stuff. Okay, so, yeah. So, you know, this is more of an individual song about being individually woke.
Yeah.
Versus normally when people talk about woke or being conscious, they're talking about, I now see all the ills of the world.
Yeah.
And I am here to fix it and tell you it's all, you know, da-da-da-da-da. And Peterson's like, man, just fix yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Then if you fix yourself, you can kind of help the people in your household. And then once you're able to help them, then go out in the city. And then you can, you know, whatever. But then most of your work is already done for you. And sort of that's the idea. That's the genius behind this statement. And I think that that's what's going on here. Like, we've got to accept this, right? Mm-hmm. Like, this is, we can't keep going on the way that we're going on.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think we're entering into a new era. What do you give the song?
I'll go to the 9.3.
Yeah, I had it as a 9.3 as well. You know, the last little song we did, everybody was mad.
You know. but I really don't know what I would have given that song had we had not 10 hours.
I just genuinely didn't like the song. I've heard it, you know, multiple times, never heard it.
Oh, really?
Okay. What I like is the Tool opening up segment, which happened in the last, you know, the 75th sort of percentile of the song, where it just opened up and did what you're kind of used to with Tool, which is great. So... Yeah, so that's a 9.3 for me as well.
Well, there you have it.
There you are. Dear listener.
We are all one spark, eyes full of wonder.
Seduct.
Like that.
Well, that, yeah, and that's like it ends with the childlike.
Yeah,
childlike
that's what I was thinking. I was picturing Orion.
Yeah, we're talking about God and the Bible boogie, and they're like, you know, why doesn't God just appear, yada, yada, yada. And I'm like, look, guys, you just get bored.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, we've got airplanes that are like literally in the air. You know, like. And we're just bored with them now. It's like people are flying.
True. How many relationships
feet?
Were ended because someone was too available?
It's just boredom. Yeah. But this is saying eyes full of wonder. Like, realize the wonder of the universe that you're in because it's freaking amazing. So, there you are, dear listener. Vin out.
Sorry out.
Gone.